talk about one of the last few processors that Compaq produced. So last one was 21364. So this one was before this, 21264. 21464 was in design when the company got bought by HP and Intel. We'll talk a little bit about 464 also, okay, if we get time. So again, just like, oh, I don't know how to fix it. Did this get, anyway, okay. So anyway, so mid-90s again, just like 100s or 10K. And the first silicon that came back from factory for this processor had roughly three times frequency compared to MIPS or 10K. So it had 15 million transistors on a 310 millimeter square die with 0.35 micron CMOS. So if you go back and look at MIPS or 10K, it had a die size of about 290 millimeter square. The number of transistors was about 6 million. So you can see that this also reflects the ingenuity of the designers that could fit with the same die size, so many transistors, which at the same transistor size. So MIPS R10K also had 0.25 micron series. Just like MIPS R10K, fetches, decodes, renames four instructions every cycle. The pipeline was taken from predecessor 21164, and essentially the out of order mechanisms such as renaming, etc., were added on top of that. The basic pipeline was just borrowed from the predecessor. It had on chip 64 kilobyte two-way set of CD VLO on instruction and data caches, and an off chip direct map L2 cache with variable size. So, again, it could vary from 1 megabyte to 16 megabyte. You could configure it at boot time. Okay. So it fetches four pre-decoded instructions from instruction cache, 32 entry return address stack is there, which helps you predict return addresses. So we discussed that earlier. So this processor introduced a new feature that is line and wave prediction. So it's essentially a branch target buffer fused with instruction cache. So what it is that for each block of four instructions, the line predictor tells you which index to fetch from next and the starting block offset in that index. Okay, so essentially, so let's say this is my instruction cache, right, which has two ways. Okay. Currently, I'm fetching from this particular cache index, let's say, okay, right, and this way. So I fetch four instructions from this index and from this way, okay, all right? And then I ask the line predictor to tell me where are my next four instructions, right? So it's essentially, it's just a predictor, okay, which predicts, probably it will say that, well, same index, next four instructions, okay, right? That's what this is going to tell you for most of the time, okay? However, if one of these instructions is a branch instruction, it will tell you where the target is, right? Predict a target. So maybe here, so it will tell you that, well, this is the next line to predict for. That's the line predictor, all right? So, so that's the line predictor. The wave predictor tells you which of the two ways to pick. So at this index, you have two possibilities, right? Whether this one or this one. So the wave predictor tells you which way to go. So prediction is correct. It provides a fast way to access a large two-way set of CD cache. So otherwise, they found that it was pretty much impossible to access a 64 kilobyte two-way cache at whatever frequency the processor was targeting. Okay. Because essentially here, if you notice, we are avoiding the time to decode the index completely. We're avoiding the time to do a comparison of tag and doing a multiplexing completely. Right? We're just asking the predictor to tell me which line, which way. I'm going to access it. But of course, in background, you'll have to continue doing the other thing, the right thing actually. You will decode the index, you will update the PC, decode the index, look up both the tags, make a comparison, find out which way is the correct one. And if you predicted it correctly, then you are fine. Otherwise, you cancel whatever you fetched based on the predictor, and we will fetch the right thing. So it also acts as a target predictor for unconditional branches, subroutine calls, and other predictable branches. So as I said, it's a, essentially a BTP fused into the instruction cache. Okay. Is this clear, this particular concept? Langevin prediction. It has a fairly sophisticated branch predictor. So the 2.64 pipeline had a 7-cycle branch penalty. Okay. This is a minimum time between prediction and branch execution. This is a minimum. This is much larger than your MIPS R2K, which had a much shorter time. So it uses a hybrid branch predictor called a tournament predictor. The basic idea is to have two different types of predictors that are good at predicting different classes of branches, and have a third meta predictor called a chooser that decides which of the two predictors to pick for each branch based on the dynamic history. So we have already discussed such predictors in the class. We have already implemented one in your homework. So this way you can pick the predictor that is good at predicting a particular branch class. So what are the two components? So it actually uses a SAG and a GAG with a bimodal meta predictor. So in your homework you implemented a SAG and a G-share. So one interesting thing that 2.64 did was speculative output of global history. So if you recall, your GAG predictor has a global history register. So in 2.64 it is 12 bits, which indexes a table of 496 entries. So these are basically saturated counters, right? And these counters will tell you the outcome of the GAG predictor. Okay. So if you just look at the GAG predictor in isolation, the problem is that there's a 7-cycle latency, minimum 7-cycle latency from prediction to the correct outcome of the branch that you know. Okay, right? So it's clear that your global history register will lag behind the correct outcome. Okay? Because now you predict a branch whose outcome will be known 7 cycles later. Okay? In between, there will be branches coming in that will actually access a stale GHR. Okay, right? So one way to avoid this problem is that you believe your predictor all the time. You say that, okay, whatever the predictor tells me, I'm going to push that in as my history. Okay. Right? So that's called speculative update of the global history register. And what it buys you is that your GHR is most of the time up to date, provided the prediction accuracy is high. Okay. Otherwise, of course, your quality in GHR big time. Okay. But of course, once in a while, your predictor will make mistakes. So then the question is, how do I really fix it? Because I have corrupted the GHR. So what you do is that, as we already mentioned, rolling back your register map, you need to make a checkpoint whenever a branch executes. So you make these 12 bits also part of the checkpoint. Okay. So whenever you detect a misprediction, branch misprediction, you will also restore the GHR from those on that checkpoint. Okay. So in case of correct prediction, there is no bubble, and 2.64 supports 20 in-flight branches. So compare that with 4 in case of R10K. So this means you need a higher prediction accuracy of a predictor, because we say that we had a thumb rule, right? We said that if I allow n outstanding branches and a prediction accuracy is p for each branch, then I want p to be n to be more than half. Okay, right? Assuming that the predictions are independent. Okay. So if you plug in 20 there for n, you can find that P will come out to 0.97, 0.98, about that. So you need an extremely high accurate branch predictor to make any sense of this particular number. Okay. And otherwise, you're guaranteed to be, not guaranteed, but most likely to be on the wrong path if P falls below that. Okay. The second stage is called slot. So here the branch prediction outcome is compared against the line and wave prediction outcome for conditional branches. And in case of a mismatch, the branch predictor overrides the results of the line and wave prediction and results in a one cycle bubble. Essentially, whatever you have fetched believing the line and wave prediction will have to be discarded. So that's the first thing that we do in this particular stage. Now the 264 has two integer ALU clusters, and each cluster has two subclusters. So we'll look into more detail about these subclusters very soon. Now the point here is that during this particular stage, the integer instructions are statically assigned to one of the two subclusters based on some scheduling constraint. So essentially, you're saying that I would statically bind an instruction to a particular subcluster of an ALU. Okay. Even though what may happen is that if you did it dynamically, it probably would have been better, because when the instruction finally becomes ready, the statically assigned subcluster may actually be busy doing something else. Okay. Whereas the other subcluster may actually be free. Okay, right? But they chose this particular design for simplicity. They said, they're statically assign this, and that's where the name comes from for this stage. This is called static slotting of instructions into subclusters. Okay. So this subcluster assignment will be used by the integer issue queue logic later for sending instructions to the proper subcluster. Okay. How stage is renamed? So this is very interesting. The way they do rename is fundamentally different from the way we have talked about in the class, and we have seen what RTNK is doing. So it supports up to 18 physical registers in integer register file and 72 in floating point register file. And for every instruction, the register map is saved. Okay. So this provides immense flexibility to you, because now you can say that for every instruction, I have a facility to roll back. Okay, because I'm checkpointing the register map on every instruction. Okay. But this also means that your register checkpoints should not be too heavy, right? It should be, because you are essentially, so they provide 80 register checkpoints. So essentially they allow 80 in-flight instructions. So to save 80 register map checkpoints, you should not require too much space. That's what is required. So it's completely different implementation compared to R10K. So let's try to look at that a little more, what they actually do. So recall that, whatever we have discussed till now, and also what R10K does, is that if you have n logical registers, you have a map table, which is n entries high, and you have if you have p physical registers, each entry will be log p plus 1 bit long, right? 1 bit long. So this extra bit is for the valid bit that we talked about. Okay, alright. So if you calculate for 80 register checkpoints, so for alpha 264, n is 32, as usual, and p they are talking about 80, right? Okay. So to be very accurate, so in this case, how much is this? Each entry is 8 bits, right? Okay. To be able to encode 80 physical registers. Okay. So one checkpoint would be 256 bits. Okay. And we have 80 checkpoints. So that's a lot of data actually. 256 bits times 80. Okay. Huge amount of data. So instead of this, what they do is, so they have a P entry table, which you have P physical registers. Okay. And each entry is log n plus 1 bit long. Okay. Alright. So again, this particular bit is for the valid bit. Okay. So this is my valid bit column. So how do you do the mapping? Whenever you get a logical register, you make a fully associative comparison. Okay. Alright? And exactly what entry is going to match. Okay. Along with the parameter. And that entry, whatever entry that is, the row number of that is going to be the physical register. Okay. Alright. So which one is better? So you're roughly comparing n log p with p log n. Which one is better? P to the n or n to the p? You can assume that p is bigger than n. It's always true. Have you established this? Any relationship? What is it? Sorry?
This is the one is bigger.
Which one is bigger? N power p is bigger. So I'll give you one example for each. P to the n is bigger than n to the p if you take p equal to 3, n equal to 2. Right? P equal to 4, n equal to 3. Right? So it's not clear, but anyway, for this particular design point, you can establish an inequality. One of these will be bigger, one of these will be smaller. So in this case, I haven't calculated, but I think this is going to be larger. Or maybe not, I don't know. Okay. That's not really important. Okay. What is important is that how do you checkpoint this? This is a gigantic table. Okay. P log n bits, whatever it is. So you can calculate, let's see. So n equal to 32. So this is going to be what? 480 bits, right? 480 bits. Okay, right? Because each entry is going to be 6 bits.
So how do you look up this map table?
I do a comparison, associated comparison with all entries. Yeah. It's a CAM, it's not a RAM. So I think this is, this is 480 bits. Okay. Whereas that one was 256 bits. Okay. So indeed, you have a larger map table. So for 80 checkpoints, if you decide to checkpoint this whole table, it's going to be gigantic. Is there a smarter way of checkpointing this? And this was a major contribution of quantum systems. Yes.
Differences? We checkpoint one of them, next instructions, there will be like, there won't be many differences in, like most of them will remain the same.
Mm-hmm.
There will be differences in some positions. If we are just saving the differences.
No, I don't understand. What do you mean by difference?
There will be some mapping that will change from one of the saved copy to the other one.
What's the worst case?
Worst case, two sources, and
how do I restore an arbitrary checkpoint? Is that easy? I have to sequentially restore, right? One after another.
So we can make say that for if we can save one of the tables, then for some five or six next tables we can save a difference. Then we can checkpoint one full table again. Something.
Can I do something better? I tell you that it's enough to save p bits. That's all. So think of an instruction, right? Currently, certain things are mapped here. how many entries are going to be valid? Two logical registers cannot have, sorry, one logical register cannot have multiple existing maps, right? So there could be only n rows that are valid, right? So if I look at this particular column, I'll find that there are exactly n turnaround bits. The remaining will be off. Does that give you a hint? So currently, whatever is mapped, okay, so we have n logical registers. They are mapped to certain n physical registers, right? Now, until this instruction commits, if I pick up any of these currently allocated physical registers, it will still have the same mapping, right? Is that guaranteed? So I look at a certain entry here, okay, which is, let's say, valid, right? So this particular some logical register here has the corresponding physical register map. Okay. When does this map get freed? When the same logical registers get redefined, right? Okay. Redefined and the instruction establishing this map. Sorry, establishing the new map actually graduates. Right? So the new map doesn't exist at this point, right? It's in the future. So from the viewpoint of the current instruction, when it graduates, I claim that all these maps will still remain unchanged. None of the physical registers can be freed. Is that correct? Because if I look at any of the mapped physical register, that will be freed only when the next producer arrives. And that has to arrive in the future. Which hasn't yet arrived there.
It could have arrived.
Then why is this particular logical register here? It should be mapped somewhere here, right? So currently I'm looking at only the most recent producer of each of the logical registers in this map table. That's the view that I have currently. Okay, right? And that view is not going to change until, when this particular instruction graduates, that view is not going to change. It's going to remain unchanged actually. So I claim that if I checkpoint this valid bit column, it's enough. So if I take an arbitrary instruction, if I want to restore the checkpoint map, all I'll do is that copy the valid bit column and put it here. That's it. Well, the valid bit column will have exactly n bits on.
Yeah.
Whichever n rows it will activate, essentially, what's the state of the map table when this instruction was invoked? That's what I'm claiming.
So, whichever n bits are enabled.
So, when this consider calculation pass.
These n physical registers were actually.
N logical registers.
Yeah.
There are n logical registers.
There are n logical registers. So only n bits are valid in this.
That's right. Yeah.
So it will map to n
physical registers.
So these n physical registers will map to actually logical registers. What is the mapping? So which physical register maps to which logical register? How do we get to know that?
No, so that's what I'm saying. So consider an instruction which you're reading currently. Okay? This is the state of the table. Currently it has some n bits on in the valid bit column. Okay. What I'm saying is that in future, at any point in time before this instruction graduates, if I want to roll the register map back to that point when this instruction was renamed, it's enough to just copy the valid bit column, what it was at that point. Because now the maps would have changed.
So when I put the checkpoint,
There
might be instruction ahead of me.
Before me. That's right. Yep.
Yes. And then they
are already renamed. Right?
They got committed and
so they are already renamed, right?
They're already renamed, yes.
So their renaming has been reflected here already.
Yes. Now
yes.
When they commit,
yes.
There might be some other instruction after me which get a new map. Will that happen?
No, so we're talking about renaming the current instruction I.
Yes.
We're talking about the instruction before me.
Yes.
Let's call it I prime, which is already renamed.
Yes.
And whatever view of the map table it has produced, it's already there.
Yes, sir.
So okay, now what happens?
I committed. I prime commits.
I prime commits.
And there's no other instruction. Yeah. So now it's mapped.
So let's suppose I prime produces register produces some logical register and not mapping to P naught.
Now this mapping can be freed.
The previous map was P naught prime, let's say. Right? So when, and let's suppose that in between there was no instruction producing N naught. Fine? Okay? So when I is renamed, P naught would say N naught. Right? So the point is that you can just checkpoint this column and you're done.
Okay.
Just 18 bits of meters. What penalty do you pay? You pay a bigger size penalty for your map table.
Okay.
But your checkpoints become very thin. Just 18 bits of checkpoint.
So the point is from allocation, from renaming to commit for instruction between there no new mapping happens in the table. Is it?
From renaming to commit of I.
Of I.
Yeah.
Table does not change.
Of course it changes. Yes. There are instructions continuously being renamed. But what I'm saying is that none of these registers which are mapped at this point cannot be freed. They will remain allocated. And that's what I'm exploiting to argue that if you want to roll back the checkpoint to this particular state, you just copy the valid bit column. Okay, so the end result is that for storing 80 checkpoints, you essentially need 6,400 bits because this is 80 bits. Okay, so. Which is of course still larger than your MIPS RTNK checkpoint because RTNK was having only 4 checkpoints which required 1024 bits. But you can imagine having 80 checkpoints here. It would be huge. Any question? Not clear.
Sir, actually for recycling,
yes.
When instruction commits, then we recycle, right?
Recycle the previous map.
Previous.
Like as I said here in the example, I prime produces logical register in not. Which I assign a new map of P naught.
Okay,
right? So if I go to the row of P naught, which is let's say this one, okay. It would basically this is P naught. It would say not here and this bit would be on. Okay, right? Let's suppose the previous map was P naught prime, okay, which is let's say this one. So P naught prime will also say N naught, but this bit will be off. Yes, so you're asking something. Yes.
So, sir,
so finally, when I prime commits, you'll recycle P naught prime. Not until then.
So, if an instruction, like for current instruction, you want to roll back.
Yes.
But if a later instruction, that cannot commit before this.
Sorry, say.
So
consider, for example, consider I prime, okay, right?
Yeah.
So, before we make this change, we checkpoint the valid bit column, okay, right? So if I want to roll back to I prime, this bit would actually become on when I copy the valid bit column,
yeah.
Right? Because the checkpoint this bit would be on.
Okay.
It becomes off only after I establish the new map.
Mm-hmm.
So valid bit column tells me exactly
okay.
What I need to do. Yeah. But of course you cannot say that after I has committed, after that after a few cycles you cannot say that, well I now want to roll back to I. No, that's not possible. Because the register map table now may have changed, you know, irreversibly, so that you cannot reverse on.
Okay.
Okay, so that was pretty neat actually. So the end result is a much more efficient register map saving and restoring hardware.
Sir, but why do they do this store this mapping for each instance?
Yeah, because they say that, so essentially this is one way of decoupling your pipeline implementation with the register map. So what may happen is that depending on your pipeline implementation, depending on how your system is designed, certain instructions may raise certain types of exceptions. So these will allow you to actually support any arbitrary exception for any instruction.
Okay.
You can just roll back the checkpoint. So this allows you to, you know, let definition of exceptions in a processor and all, if you have this particular flexibility. And of course, I mean, later also you can modify your processor to say that, well, although you can checkpoint all these, I only allow you to checkpoint for branches. You only turn on that particular one. So possible to restore register map at any arbitrary instruction in a single cycle, not just branches. So in this particular stage, every instruction is also assigned a reorder buffer entry. This serves the purpose, same purpose as the active list, just a different name, but much bigger. So active list was 32 entries in R10K, these 80 entries. It allows you to have 18 flight instructions in the pipeline. Okay. Each instruction is also assigned to one of the two issue queues. So there are essentially two issue queues. One is the integer queue, other one is the floating point queue. Integer queue holds all integer ALU and load store instructions. Essentially all instructions that need to read the integer register file. Okay. So notice the difference with R10K. R10K had a separate queue for load store operations. The second one is floating point queue, holds all FPU and floating point store instructions. So essentially these are all the instructions that need to read the floating point register file. So there is a slight problem with floating point stores because they need to read integer register file for computing address, but they need to read floating point register file for getting the value to be stored. Right? So they essentially say that, well, we would put these instructions in the floating point queue, okay, but for address computation, they actually do some inter queue communication. So floating point stores are special, need to read both integer file for address operand and floating point file for data operand. So they are split into two separate instructions, namely address part goes into the queue and data part goes to floating point.
So loads also?
Loads would write to the register file. Yeah, so floating point loads are given. So they are here, the queues are defined in terms of the read ports, how they bind to the read port, not the write. Okay, so how do you issue? The 20 entry integer queue can issue at most 4 instructions every cycle out of order to the pre-assigned ALU subcluster. So we have already done that, the slotting part. Okay. And the 15 entry floating point queue can issue at most 2 instructions every cycle out of order. Right. So by out of order, I mean that these queues are collapsible. That is, by you can pull out instructions from the middle, which would create holes in the queue. So you have to collapse the queue so that you create space towards the table for new instructions. Because one requirement is that whatever instruction is present in the queue, they must be maintained according to the age. Okay, that's very important, actually. Right? Because that would guarantee fairness. Essentially, in a cycle, if there are multiple instructions that become ready, the older instructions are given priority so that they can move forward. The issued load instructions are now allocated in a 32 entry load queue and stay there until granted. Okay. So once they have issued from the integer queue, they sit in another separate queue, which is called the load queue. The store instructions go to the 32 entry store queue. The store queue entries are wider than the load queue entries to be able to hold up to 64 bit of stored data. So remember that the data gets moved to cache only at that. So you can think of the load and store queues as two parts of the R10K address queue with one major difference. The load instructions are now executed out of order, which was not the case for R10K. Okay, they will send load and store instructions in order. Stage 5, operand read. The integer ALU cluster has its own copy of the register file, integer register file. These are kept coherent through a one cycle intercluster transfer bus. So remember that there are two ALU clusters. and each ALU cluster has its own copy of the ETL file. So that creates a problem of coherence, right? Because one cluster may modify some register here, which may not reflect, which may not be reflected here. So there is a one cycle inter-cluster transfer pass. So with a single cycle, you can actually make it coherent, okay? Which actually has implication, because now what it means is that suppose you send an instruction which produces, let's say, register 10 in cluster 1. And you send an instruction which consumes register 10 in cluster 2. So this cluster 2 instruction is going to be delayed because of this one cycle inter-class transfer. Okay. So the scheduler was smart enough, actually, to push instructions belonging to the same dependence chain to the same ALU cluster, okay. Which also has some downside, because what may happen is that one cluster may become very crowded, okay, but the other cluster may be narrow. So their scheduling algorithm takes care of these things. So the issued instructions read their source operands from the respective cluster register file. The floating point instructions read their operands from the floating point register file. The next cycle, the operand values may be overwritten by the bypass values. So this one we have also seen. This is the traditional bypass paths.
So why do they have separate register files for the ALU?
Yeah, why don't you guess? That's a very good question. Why would you like to separate the register file? Why not a unified register file, right? So in this case, as we said, let's see, or have we already said? Doesn't matter. So if you think about it, right? Let's suppose that the clusters are symmetric. Let's assume for the sake of argument, right? Okay. So then if you look at each of these register file, individual files, right? They would have some number of ports, right? If you unify it, the number of ports will be added, right? And that would slow down the register file. So what they found was that this one cycle penalty was far better than unifying the register file. And they will make sure that your scheduling algorithm won't require this particular one cycle transfer too frequently. Okay. They will make sure that the instructions, dependent instructions, get directed to the same cluster. So from stage 6 onward, the instructions execute on appropriate functional limits. The two integer clusters are not exactly symmetric. Each cluster is divided into an upper subcluster that is U0 or U1 and a lower subcluster that is L0 and L1. So essentially you can think of it as four ALUs. Right? So this is ALU0. This is ALU1. The lower subclusters are identical and each contains logic units, one adder, and a load store virtual address calculator. So that's your L0 and L1. Okay, so you have logic, you have adder, and you have address calculator. U0 contains an integer multiplier, a shift unit, a branch unit, logic units, and an integer adder. So that's your U0. And U1 is identical to U0 except it does not have the multiplier, but has a motion video unit and some special arithmetic instructions like population count, leading zero count, etc. So this particular instruction, pop count, counts the number of ones in a particular bit pattern, right? And the leading zero count is essentially tells you how many zeros are there on the MSB, on the most significant side, until you hit a one. Right? So as you can see, overall, what you get is one multiplier. There are four logic units, because all the subclusters have one each. There are three adders, L0, L1, and U0. Sorry, four adders, U0, U1 also. Yeah. And you have two branch units, two shifters and two address calculators, right? Okay. The floating point unit, so there are four in number. What are they? A fully pipelined multiplier, a fully pipelined adder, an unpipelined divider, and an unpipelined square root. So you might have noticed that there is no integer divider. They actually use this one for doing integer division. Okay. The load store unit, so the load store instructions calculate their virtual addresses in L0 or L1. They issue out of order from the integer queue, as already mentioned. At this time, they are also placed in either the load queue or the store queue. These two queues are maintained in order. That is, older instructions are closer to the head. So essentially what it means is that once you put something in the load queue, the order cannot be violated. Alright? However, they can be put in the load queue from the integer queue out of order. Okay. So loads may execute out of order, stores execute in order. When a store issues, it checks all the instructions in the load queue that are after it in program, in the program order. And in case of an address conflict, meaning the load has probably got a wrong value, it initiates a squash starting from the offending load, and a refetch is started from the offending load. So you need to restore the register maps, etc. Okay, so this one we have also discussed earlier. So this particular problem, when we issue loads out of order. So there's also one reason why you would like to checkpoint your register map for load instructions as well, right? Because any load can run across this particular problem. And MIPS RTMK did not have this problem because they did not issue loads out of order. So to minimize the possible squashes due to out of order load issue, the processor uses a load weight table. Okay. So what is this? This table is indexed by the load program counter. And it tells the issue unit whether to hold the load back until all stores before it can issue. And how do we really decide this? This table is updated whenever a load gets squashed due to a store conflict, so that in future the load will be held back and will not be issued speculatively. So it's a very simple table which essentially identifies load instructions that are prone to this problem, right? And they will be conservatively held back. You will not speculatively issue them out of order. So every issuing load checks all instructions in the store queue before it, and in case of a perfect match, which means matches the size and the address, it simply picks up the stored value and does not even access the cache. So this is a load forwarding case where you have a load and you have a store before it, and the load completely overlaps with the store. So the value can be taken from the store to itself. In RTMK, we talked about load heap speculation in connection with issuing load dependence, right? So we said that we issue a dependent of a load speculatively without knowing if the load is going to hit in the cache or not. So RTMK always optimistically speculates that the load will hit, which is why it always does this speculation. And if it misses, we'll have to squash the dependent and reissue it later when the load value is available. We could have issued an independent instruction in that issue cycle if we knew that this load would miss, right? So we could have utilize that particular slot. Essentially, one issue cycle is wasted if the load misses. So 2.64 uses a load hit miss predictor for this purpose. When a load issues, it predicts using a table based on the history whether it is going to hit or miss this time. Just like a branch predictor tells you, take one or not. So it's a binary predictor. That's yes, no. The prediction is hit. If the prediction is hit, then only the issue logic may consider issuing dependence of the loads. If the prediction is missed, it will not do so. It will hold back the dependence until it knows for sure the fate of the load. Okay. So the last stage of the pipeline, retirement of commit. 2.64 commits at least 8 instructions every cycle. Under certain situations, it can sustain a retirement bandwidth of up to 11 instructions for a short period. So why am I doing this? Why is my retirement rate more than my fetch rate? I was fetching four every cycle. I'm saying that I can sustain up 11 instructional retirement every cycle. Why am I doing this? What's the rationale behind it? What do I gain by quickly retiring them? They have already executed. These are completed instructions.
Just freeing up the entries.
Exactly. So freeing up not the entries, it also frees up other resources like registers and everything.
Okay.
So these are essentially, you know, completed instructions. They're just sitting there holding resources. So the sooner you let them go, the better, because they will free up more resources. So when an instruction comes to the end of the ROD, it can be considered for retirement. So what does it do when it retires? It updates the branch predictor. It frees the register map copy for this instruction. So remember that every instruction has a register map checkpoint. Okay, right? You have to free it at this time because you don't need it anymore. It moves the stored data from store queue to the L1 data cache, if it's a store. It frees the load store queue entry, if it's a load or a store. It frees the old physical destination register and updates free list and frees the ROD. So next time we'll talk about detailed metrics.